Welcome to Introduction to Deep Learning workshop for image recognition. Before we get started, just want to ensure that everyone's so everyone got in the updated notebooks? Did everyone clone or download the notebooks? Anyone still working on the installation? Okay, so the easiest way to do installation is just install Anaconda. And once you install Anaconda, you just install pip install keras, and then you're all set. Anyone else need help in setting it up? Okay, two questions for you guys. How many of you have never done machine learning before? Okay, wow, not many. How many of you don't know Python? Okay, all of you know Python, okay. Okay, this is so... First time I'm having a crowd like this where everyone's knows Python, so cool. If you're on using Git, just do git pull and check if everything's up to date. You should see a data folder and a notebooks folder. If you have, then you're good. Okay, the structure for today's will be something like this. I'll spend the first 20 to 30 minutes talking about the theory, and then we'll go and implement hands-on building neural networks from scratch. And then we'll introduce the problem, we'll get started doing some of the stuff, recognizing images. And once we finish that, I'll come back and do a little bit more theory on some of the newer techniques that's being used in deep learning. And then we'll go back and implement it. So the theory part, the slides would be like 30, 45 minutes, and the remaining about 2.5 hours, you would be coding it up. Okay, so we'll get started. We're going to do something like this now. So the caveat here is that I'll probably cover upon a lot of things. Some of the things are fairly mathematical, and I wouldn't go into it at all. But I'll give you pointers to where you can go and learn about that. That'll help you get more details about those particular topics. We'll also not cover the latest state of art techniques. If you have question and answers, we can always talk about it, maybe towards the end or offline. This is a fairly introductory material to neural networks and deep learning. As I told before, this is the schedule that we are going to follow. We're going to talk about the need for neural networks, deep learning, what's the motivation is, and then some of the building blocks for these kinds of units. And then we'll talk about convolutional neural networks. That's the current awesome algorithm for image recognition. Okay, so let's start with something fairly simple. This is the problem that we're going to work on today, the problem of handwritten, recognizing handwritten digits. How do we recognize the digits? When we look into it, we probably can accurately know what all those digits are, 5, 0, 4, 1, 9, 2. But if we're going to do using machine learning, most of you are familiar with machine learning, the way we would do is we take the input, and which is basically the raw image, and we create features out of that, and that's fed in to a model, an learning algorithm. We train the model, and we get an output. An example is a k-nearest neighborhood where we look into images which are very similar to the one that we are having. In some sense, this is just creating one function that summarizes your entire model. The problem here is that it's very difficult to list down all the features that define a particular data, right? So if you have image, it could be, okay, do I have patches on the left? Do I have patches on the right? And this is just one, and you can always start, is it rounded in the top? Is it rounded in the below, in the bottom? You can do all sorts of stuff. And it just gets out of control. It's very hard to figure out what all those features are and then use that to create models. And at any point of time, you can always create more features with what you have. And then the goal is, can we think of any other way of doing this? Stepping back, how do we learn? When we want to learn, there are three things that's very important. We want to know how the information is detected, which is what we call the features. We also want to know how it's stored. And given what we have detected and how it's stored in our brain, we want to know how it influences recognition. It's got some biological connection. I'm going to skip this. But think about how kids learn. You start talking to them for the first 1-2 years. You keep talking to them. And then at some point, the flip happens, and they start talking. And you're like, will they even stop? So it's something like this, right? So you know that there's something that's happening. And if you observe kids, they're like a very good example of how people learn. That you keep, you don't teach grammar until they start primary school, but by age 3, 4, by definitely 5, they talk almost perfect grammar, and they do it only by listening. So they listen a lot, and that's what people tell, that you tend to listen a lot when you're young, and as you grow older, you tend to talk a lot. We call that in machine learning terminology the training samples. You get a lot of training samples. You train yourself on that. And then when you have enough information, you can start understanding things. There's also the other thing that given a flowing liquid like water, you would easily be able to figure out if it's a drinking water or a small river or a huge ocean. So one of the things which neuroscientists have figured out is that we build the context hierarchically. So coming from the visual cortex to where the recognition happens in the brain, there are a lot of neurons which gets connected at each layer. We construct things in a different way. So this is like a motivation for doing neural networks, where we take some. So if you look into it, the fundamental processing unit is a neuron. Like in our brain, in neural networks, this is the one that you see in the center is a neuron, where given all the inputs that you see, it takes it and it does some transformation. It's a functional transformation and gives an output. So a neuron has a function. The function is called activation function. We will talk about what kinds of functions can be used very soon. These are the inputs that you see. So these are real raw inputs. There's no transformation on that. You take that, you create, and they're all, each particular input has some weight associated with it. And then a transformation happens and you get an output. That's the processing of a simple neuron. If you think about what happens in the brain, you see something and then it transfers some sort of electrical impulse back to the next layer. Okay, so this is an architecture of a very simple neural network. You have inputs, you have something called the processing layer, the hidden input, hidden layer, and that's an output. If there's only one unit, that's similar to what you have in your machine learning model, where you just have one processing unit which learns the function, and you take your data, it processes the function, and you have an output. Instead, here, we have, instead of having one individual unit, we have networked units. So you have an input, and it passes on to all the hidden layers. It processes it, and it influences your output. So the activation functions remain constant throughout your learning. What changes is the weights that when each neuron connects to the other neuron in the next layer, the weights is what has to be learned. A simple neural network model is a feed-forward network where everything goes from the left to the right. There's no feedback. There's no interaction of your output node or a node in your next layer to your previous layer. There are no feedback connections. There are architectures where people use feedback connections, but that's not something that we would be covering today. We're going to talk only about feed-forward networks today, where your inputs for a particular layer are only coming from the previous layer. Okay, so we talked about activation function. This just gives the output given all the inputs that it gets. Another terminology is something like this is called a dense network. A dense network is one where a node is connected to all, a neuron is connected to all neurons in the next layer. So that's called a dense network. So now we'll talk about different kinds of activation functions. Activation functions, it takes inputs and it does some transformation and gives an output. The simplest of the activation functions is called perceptron, where you take all inputs, you multiply it by a weight, and if it's greater than a particular threshold, you set the output to be one. If the threshold is less, if the sum product of your input with the weights is less than the threshold, you set it to zero. So the value would be something like this. Until a particular threshold, all values below it are zero, and it's one otherwise. The problem here is it gives only a value either zero or one. So we'll think of other ways that if you've done machine learning, you know that logistic unit is something that's widely used. This is the function, this is the logistic unit, 1 over 1 plus e to the minus z. It's called a logistic or sigmoid function. The value for any value of y, it's always between 0 and 1. It's got some really nice properties that really helps in neural network architecture. So logistic unit works when you have one unit, but if your output layer has multi-class, then you would want to use something called softmax, which is just a generalization of logistic regression. It basically ensures that the output is squished between 0 and 1, and it sums up to 1. So the summation of all your output layers is equal to 1. That's the main difference between what you see from sigmoid unit to a softmax unit. If you're using a multi-class, then you use softmax as your activation function. Okay. We'll talk about this a little later on, other kinds of units. So how does learning happen in machine learning? It uses an algorithm called gradient descent. If you think about, you're standing at a particular place, you want to slowly go in the direction of the steepest descent. That's what gradient descent does. Your cost function is convex, and you want to go in the path where the descent is the steepest, where the gradient is the steepest. But you just move a little. We call this the alpha or eta. It's called the learning rate. You don't go all the way down, but instead you do it at step by step. But if you think about it, when you're at a particular place, you want to compute gradient. In machine learning, it's easy. It's easier because you just have one unit, and you can find out what the gradient is for that particular unit. You can take the derivative with respect to the weights, and you can obtain the gradient. But in a highly dense networked architecture like neural networks, how do we compute the gradient? So to do that, we use an algorithm called backpropagation algorithm. I'll explain it in an intuitive way. I'll give links later on where you can go and read the math behind this. But this is what it does. The goal is to find gradients of each of the neurons with respect to your cost function. So you have to compute gradients of the loss function with respect to each of the weights that comes from the neurons. You have the error from your last, that's what you find when you finish modeling. You finish one pass of your training, you know what the error is. So you have to adjust your weights. So you backpropagate the errors to generate deltas for all the neurons in the hidden layer. So you would know what the error for each one of those, what the deltas are. And then when you know the deltas for each one of the neurons, then you can use gradient descent to update weights for that particular neuron. So that's what happens. The challenge here is that when you're dealing with large data set, it's very difficult to do a full gradient descent. So we do something called a stochastic gradient descent in neural networks. What it tells is that instead of taking all your training data, you just take a batch, called a mini batch, batches of data. You train on that, you update the weights, and then take the other batch. So for example, you split your data into 10, you train it on your first batch, you update the weights, then take the second batch, update the weights. This goes on till your 10th batch gets completed. And once that's done, we call it one epoch is completed. And then we keep running those epochs multiple times to get your updated weights until the error gets lower than your threshold. If you just set your mini batch size to 1, it's called online learning. It's generally very low, slow. If you do, we typically do a mini batch. The simplest architecture for neural networks is this multi-layer perceptron, where input gets fed on to all the outputs. All the hidden layers. and it, we use, even though it's called multilayer perceptron, we don't use perceptron as the activation function. We use sigmoid as the activation function. It multiplies, it, then you have a sigmoid output that gets an input, and that's how multilayer perceptron work. This is one layer multilayer perceptron. If you have more than one layer, as the number of layers increase, we call that deep learning because the architecture is deep. For a long time, such architectures were not being able to be trained because there used to be a severe case of overfitting. In the last few years, because of advent in technology and also better algorithms to solve overfitting issues have resulted in better algorithms being churned out for deep learning. Just to tell, okay, so we have, when you watch YouTube videos, the caption that you see is auto caption, it automatically comes. That's an example of deep learning. When you take photos on your phone, it automatically knows where your faces are. This is an example of deep learning. And these are places where you can also use, after training, you can use it to generate images called, some of these things are very cool. Okay, now, any questions before we start the code? Okay, so, sure. It doesn't show me here, but there's an ATT Wi-Fi, and there's no password for it. Okay. Any more questions? A version of it. I will upload these slides and I'll post it on the repository after today. Okay, go into the. Okay, go into the repository, and then go into the notebooks folder. Anyone still working on the installation? Does everyone have the notebook? Anyone still working on getting the notebooks? Piano? I mean, just install Anaconda. Anaconda comes with Piano. So we'll use Jupyter notebooks as the IDE for today. How many of you have no experience with Jupyter notebooks? Okay, so we'll wait for the installation to be completed. I'll just do a quick 2-minute overview of the notebook. Am I audible? Yes. Okay. So on your shell, enter Jupyter notebook, and then enter. It opens a browser. Everyone of you see the browser? Yes. Okay. So let's create a new Python 3 notebook. You can name it that's how you name the notebook. This is a cell where we'll enter the command. The cell can be either a code or a markdown or a heading. The default is code. So let's do, and then if you do a shift enter, it executes the command. This line, this number here tells that executed. So it tells that there's no module named, so it's wrong. So so it's easy operating on this. So you can change it to markdown to give headings, and so that's all there is to notebook. All your IPython magic functions will work here. It's pretty cool. So we'll go ahead and we'll close this. Okay. So we'll start with this particular notebook one. So we'll go in order 1 through 7. One is introduction to neural networks. So we'll use whatever we learned so far and we'll build it from scratch so you get a sense of how this works. This is not an optimized code. In practice, we'll never ever use an approach like this. We'll only use libraries. I'll just do this for the purpose of explaining, and then we'll go and get started. Let's import some of the libraries that we need. NumPy is the numerical Python library. Matplotlib is the plotting library. We'll need some of these, so let's just run it. The next line tells us to read the data. This is from a pandas command, read CSV. Let's just see what train has. So to insert a cell, just do insert, cell above or cell below. You can get that. So the data set has two features, feature one, feature two, and has target. It's a binary class. This is a generate data set function in SQL, and I just use that to generate this. It's easy to replicate a toy data set like this. So we're going to assign, split this data set into train and target. Feature one and two will be part of something called X, and we assign the target to Y. We convert that to an NumPy array, so now it's stored as a NumPy array. So you can check the type is a NumPy array. If you look into the first five records, is this visible or should I make it bigger? It's good. Okay. So it displays the first five rows, and which you can see is the same as above. I mean, these are just basic checks to see if it's fine. If you already know NumPy, then, but just for people to get a hang of typing some code. So let's go and visualize how the data is. So if you look into it, I don't know. So it looks like there is some structure, but we don't know how good this is. So let's build a neural network model for classifying this. The first thing that we would do is we'll need to generate a random number. These are used to initialize the weights. So initially, when we start, we're going to initialize the weights. So if you look into the architecture that we had for here, so these weights will be randomly generated when you start. We'll use the logistic. We'll use the sigmoid unit. We start with, we're just going to fill everything with zeros. Okay, so it's here. We'll use the sigmoid activation unit. This is for finding for the gradient. We'll use the okay. So now we'll talk about the class that we have. It has it's defined by three parameters: your number of input, number of units. So this is still one layer, one hidden layer. So this is the number of neurons in your hidden layer, and it tells the number of neurons in your output layer. We initialize the weights. First, we create the number, the weight matrix, and then we randomly initialize the weight matrix. Once we do that, the next thing that we need is to do a backpropagation to find what the gradients at each neuron for each weights. To propagate the weights, propagate the error. So it's we start with okay. These are basic checks. This is where we are going to do the error. That's going to get propagated from the output layer to the previous layer, and this is what finds the error in the hidden layer. Once we do that, we're going to update the weights. This is done through gradient descent. This is the gradient descent, same. And you're doing the weights. The class is, so we're just combining the last two cells into this particular cell. It's got the you just initialize it, and then you have a backpropagation algorithm where you're updating your stuff. Okay, so we'll run this particular model on something very simple. We're going to tell that I'm going to create something with two input neurons and one hidden unit and one output. That's all that it tells. Okay, let's run this. So let's run it for two times and see that the error is. So you can always run it for a much larger time. Okay, this gives the prediction. Can run the prediction. The actual prediction. You can see that the minimum that it gets. And it goes. The maximum is only, so if you use a threshold of 0.5, it's going to classify everything as zero. It's not really very good. This is just a helper function to visualize what we have done so far. So let's just see what it does. So this is what it does. It sets on the, in this, we're going to set everything less than, so greater than, we're going to set a threshold of 0.5, and everything greater than 0.5, we're setting it to 1, and less than 0.5, we're setting it to 0. And we see that the model classifies everything as 0. Oh, okay. So the color, it's setting a color. So there's no, it's all uniform color. It's all the same color. To see that, let's run now with 10 hidden units. So in the same unit that we just did, instead of doing it for 2, we'll run for 10 units. And then plot it and see how the results are. And the code is there, just see if you see a difference. Okay, I will do that. Okay. I'll do that. Run this. Okay, now we have. We see 2 classes, right? So it's not, the accuracy is not so great, but. Sorry? This line separates the 2 classes, yes. Okay, so that's, why, so you're telling it should be nonlinear? We just have 1 layer, and so you can increase the number of neurons, and you can still do it. But it's still going to show a linear because the way it's plotted. Let's try running it for 100. I hope it doesn't break. Yes. I'm just running it for 100 units with 100 iterations. You can see that the error doesn't really decrease. We'll talk about the reasons later today. So you can see that for a number of iterations, it was almost similar, and then suddenly it drops. So the number of neurons that you would have, the number of layers you would have, these are all hyperparameters of your model. And so in machine learning, if you have a lot of hyperparameters, what do? How do you select them? Cross-validation, okay. Yeah, okay. Okay, so your question is, what's cross-validation? Sure. Right, okay, I will come to that. Okay, so it finished running with, is it still running? Okay, it's still trying to plot. Okay, this is going to take a while. It's, 100 iterations and 100 neurons. Yes. You build it up through experiments. So it's kind of hard. This is the data set that we're using for today. And if you look into it, it starts from 1998, where the accuracy was like 12%. This is not even a neural network model. And then somewhere down the line, it went from nearest neighborhood to tree-based models. And then this has just been evolving, right? So then people started using SVMs. And at some point, started playing around with neural network models, but it's a character data set. Yes. So a slightly harder problem is the ImageNet dataset, and in the ImageNet dataset, if you see, the error had been very high until last 2-3 years, and people have been able to solve it through deep networks, just stacking layer after layer, doing something different. Some of the things that we would see later on today, but again, the answer has predominantly been stacking more layers than about, okay, can we experiment with this architecture? What's the result? And that's how it's been. But in broad sense, like broadly two classes of architectures. What we're seeing now is what we'll see today is convolutional neural networks, which is used for image-based datasets. And if you want to do natural language processing, then you use something called recurrent neural network, where you allow for data from your next layer to feed in to your previous layer. So with feedback. So these are the two broad architectures, but there's a lot of small fine tunings that happens, and then it gets called by a new name, and it's very active in research. This is where all our gaming system comes to help. Okay. Yes. I'll do that before I move away from this notebook. I have no idea why. Okay. So here comes your you wanted nonlinear, so it takes like more than about 100 iterations with 100 to get somewhat nonlinear. So yeah, I just used 100 for my hidden layer. And it might be also because we're setting it randomly. Just try it running it again. I mean, so we'll solve these problems when you get to the library. This is just a toy example. Okay, so I've gotten two questions. I'll first answer what cross-validation is. So when you build models, you don't use all your training data to build a model. Instead, so if you do that, you might build something which, because there are like so many connecting units, it's true even for machine learning. That's what happens in machine learning too, that when you use all your training data to build your model, you want an estimate of what your generalized error of your model is. And the only way to do, so you cannot train a model, put it into production and observe it, go back and tweak it. You want to tweak even before you put the model into production. The way you do that is you take your data and split it into, the first is the train test split. So you can split your data into 80-20. We'll train your model on 80 and then test it on your 20 to see what the accuracy is. So you use accuracy. So here I'm reporting the accuracy of on the entire training data, which is cheating. You'll never do that in practice. You will keep something called a holdout. You'll run it on the holdout and you find what the error is. And then you would use that to report. Again, the problem is if you do 80-20, you might very well end up with the best 20 or the worst 20, right? So what you do is you split your data into 5 or 10 times, and you use, say, 5 times. So you use 1, 2, 3, 4 parts of it, and then test on your 5. Then you do 1, 2, 3, 5, and then you build the model, and you test on your 4. And so you will have, like, we call this 5-fold cross-validation. And if you do 5 folds and you take an average of it, it's a bit slightly better estimate than what you would have with just 1 split. Okay, so now let's go back to the code. And okay, we'll go over the class one more time. Now, when you want to define an architecture, so this is where we are said defining the architecture. This code is meant only for one hidden layer, but you can easily extend this to multiple layers. So it tells the number of neurons in your input layer. So it tells the number of inputs that's going to come for each particular observation. Oh, you have some install issues? Okay. Sure. Okay. this tells the number of input neurons, number of inputs that will come, the features that you see in your input observation for one observation. This will be the number of processing units, neurons in your hidden layer. This will tell how many outputs do you need. So here we just have one output, 0 or 1. So this is just 1. We'll start with where we'll do the bottom-up approach. We're going to call, once we specify this, we're going to call the train function. We're going to train it on x and y, and we pass the number of iterations that it needs to do. Iterations is called epochs in neural networks. We are not doing a mini batch on this example, but we'll do mini batch on another similar code that we will run after we do a little more on the image recognition data set. So the train function has something, so we're going to pass the patterns has both x and y. It, iterations, n, m. So forget n is your learning parameter, the number of the step size through which you can update your use, which you use to update your weights. Okay. So we're going to, for all your data in your, so what the your range of iterations will give you the number of all your data in your data set. I'm going to set error to 0, and I'm going to find what the error is, right? And I'm going to update my error. So the function that gets called is two things. First is activate. So let's see what activate does. Activate, it just sets the input. So you just take the input layer, you take the inputs, and then you, once you do a feed forward of it, you want to find what the backpropagation is. So you do a feed forward of your network, you find what the error is, and once you have an error, you go back and you update your weights. That's what one iteration does. So activate will do a feed forward of it, and then you're going to do a backpropagate of your error, which is what this does. So there are two layers. One is your output layer, and another is a hidden layer. So you update both your output. You find what the delta for your output layer is for each of your neuron. And you also find for your hidden layer, hidden deltas. And then once you find the gradients, this is basically finding the gradients. And once you have the gradients, you update the weights. This is your gradient descent happening. And then once you have that, you find what your overall error is, and then you report that.
So you kind of go back and update your input weights based off of the errors that you get?
Right. So if you, I'll give this example. This is easier to understand. So what, when you start, you take your input when it enters the loop. This is called a feed forward. So it passes through the entire network. You compute everything. The weights are already there. You find the output. When you have the output, you know what the error is, right? So once you have the error, you're going to backpropagate the error. You need to find gradient for, yes. That's the algorithm, backpropagation algorithm. So it's okay, it's just chain rule. So you have some, you have a cost, your cost function, and your cost function, if you take for a sigmoid, you take a cost function, you find the derivatives, and you just need to find what the gradient at each of the weights are. The derivation is slightly mathematical, so we'll skip that for now, but I think that there is something. I'll give you a good link to understand backpropagation using maths. Yes. Correct. No, this is still one layer. Just still a toy example. So we'll go back. So this is just an implementation to understand the various things that go into a model. We'll go and implement all of those things in Keras, which does everything. The library does all this stuff. So we'll... No, it's not number of layers. It's... No, that's what I mentioned. So yeah, it's just one layer, but the number of neurons. Yes. That's debatable. I showed an example where it still comes a nonlinear boundary. here. Okay, I have to exit this. Over here. So okay, so we have the output and it needs to find the gradient at each of the neurons. And once you have that, you can use gradient descent to update the weights for, so you know what the output coming from that is and what the gradient is, and you can update it. That's what the backpropagation algorithm does. Make sense? Yes? Okay. I will, so there's this wonderful book called Neural Networks. And this book called Neural Networks and Deep Learning.com. And how backpropagation algorithm works. I recommend you to read this. This explains in detail about how this happens. So just take something and then, no, take something. That's a daemon, yes. That's a good daemon which is trying to correct your weights. But anyway, there's four equations that backpropagation tells. I'm trying to find that, okay. Yeah, so one, mathematically, this is what happens for backpropagation.
What are the units for the error given in when you run, like, so for the first one you ran, for the 2-1-1 case?
Mm-hmm.
It gives you the error, but it gives you a unit of, I think, like 34.
Right.
I don't know what that means.
Yeah, so that's...
Is that just relative units?
No, it's just a mean squared error. Mean squared error, yes. Let's see. Yes. Yeah, so that's what the activation, that's what it does. So here, everything is an activation function. It goes and computes it on the entire network. So. Yeah, it is the sigmoid of Z. I mean, okay, so. Yeah, sigmoid of Z for all the neurons, and that gets fed into the output, and that's what, right. Okay, so we'll now go to our data set, the image handwritten recognition data set, and see how to do this. Okay, please open notebook 2. Okay, we'll still not introduce keras here. We'll do it in the next section, but the first thing to do is set the full path to your data set, and we'll load the training and S dataset. Yeah, you need to give the full path. Yeah. You need to give, it's not the relative path. Please give the full paths. Because here it takes it relative to where keras is loaded. OK, so we'll load the data set now. The data set has 60,000 samples. OK, so now that we did, there's a bunch of exercises for you guys to do here. What is the type of X train? How do we do this? Type of X train. It's a NumPy array. So how do you find the number of observations in training data? And these are basic things that you see when you get your data set, right? So there are two ways to do it. One is length of X train would give me the number of observations. But xtrain.shape will give me the number of features I have. So it tells that I have 60,000 images, each of 28 by 28. So it's 28 pixels, 28 pixels. OK, we can display the numbers to record. Can display the first in regards of Y train. OK, so now we want to figure out number of observations in each digit.
Sorry, can you stop for a second? So sure. Where, how do you get the data loaded?
You have to give the full path here. Absolute path, yes. Oh, no. No, don't load it from, so if you give the full, path to your workshop data folder, if you give the path, it loads it from there. Otherwise, it loads it. Works, okay. No, I think if you have a typo. I think if you have a typo, it gives an error. Maybe I can check that. Oh, interesting. That's okay. Okay, these are basic data analysis you do on sanity check on your data before you start looking into it. We're going to see the number of observations for each digit in Y train. Any idea how to do this? Dot? Collections.counter, okay. Will it, I don't know, okay. We have to import collections for that, right? So no, that's not vectorized, I guess. So we'll use, if you do, so np.unique will give me all the unique values in ytrain. Okay, and then I'm going to give return counts equal to true. That tells me for each array how much do I have. So if you want to do this in percentage, I just divide it by Okay, everything's roughly 10% of the data set for 10 digits. Okay, so np.unique will give you the number of unique values. You add something called return counts. That'll give me the counts of everything, and then I divide the counts by the length to get the percentage. Okay, what is, so one thing we generally try to see by doing this is to see if the data set is balanced or not. And this gives you clues on where your data is heading to, if one particular class dominates. So that's something that you have to be careful when you start training on a data set like this. It's always good to have balanced data sets, but that doesn't happen all the time. Okay, you can do the same thing for train. I'm going to just copy and paste it here on test. So you see that this is also approximately around 10%. So now it's no one single class which dominates, or there's no one single class which doesn't have enough data. Okay, so now that we do, let's get into some image part of it and let's display the first training data. We use matplotlib. We're training, this basically defines the canvas, and then we are going to tell that show the first training, it's basically zero. So looks like 5. You can also go and display the 11th. It starts at 0 indexing, so okay, the reason why, so this is a 28 by 28 image. It's really small. We are actually blowing it up to this particular shape, and that's the reason why see a lot of. Okay, so we have a bunch of images and we're going to work on this. Okay, I'll open notebook 4. Yeah, sure. Yeah, so that's what's the dimension of fixed train? Yes, so it's an image. So if you think about if you want to manually construct features, everything will come as a different feature. But here we're passing on the raw image itself. And then we're going to build models just using the raw image. OK, so 3 also implements it from scratch. It's a different implementation. We'll skip that for now. If you want to look into it, you can look into it. It has a lot more comments, and it's taken from this particular book that I referred to earlier. It's an implementation of neural networks for this particular data set. Okay. Any other question before we get started on this? So from now on, we'll use libraries to do the processing. So there are a few implementations of neural networks deep learning in Python. The most popular famous one is Theano. It's probably the oldest one too. And then you have Cafe. And then recently, since last year, we have TensorFlow. So these are different implementations of it. Theano uses a lot of symbolic computations. It's not for the faint-hearted. It's not easy to get started on Theano. So keras is a wrapper that's on top of any of the base libraries. So it currently has interface to both Theano and TensorFlow. By default, it takes Theano, unless we specifically mentioned that the backend is TensorFlow. Yeah, I haven't checked tested this code on TensorFlow, so we'll have to check. Some of the things may not work, but I think you have to import. So there are two ways to do it. One is a configuration file. It's just a JSON. You just change from Theano to TensorFlow. It's just one change in the entry, and it takes it, assuming that you've already installed TensorFlow. Otherwise, you can also do it in prompt. I think you'll have to import. I think the command is from keras import, backend, and you have to do something. There's no doc string. Okay, you have to set it through that, I guess. The keras documentation has details on how to do the backend. So it's just here. So if I just change this particular value to TensorFlow, it works. Okay. So we're going to build a sequential model, a feed-forward model. It's also another class of model called graph models. We'll not get into this today. We're going to build only sequential models. We'll import dense layer, where what dense tells us that everything in one layer is connected to all neurons in the previous layer and to the next layer. We'll call the activation function. I'll come into flatten a little while later. So run this, and when you run this, it doesn't tell for me, but it. So if you tell import keras, it tells that it's using Theano as the backend. Okay, set the full path to your data set again. If you don't do that, it takes it from. So a few things here. We have the data set as 60,000 for train and 10,000. I'm going to reshape it. So the first way, the first kind of model that we're going to use is going to take every pixel as an input, and we're feeding it into the network, right? So 28 by 28, we reshape it into 784. So instead of having a 28 by 28, it's just one vector of 784, right? So 784 is 28 into 28. And then we're reshaping it. Pixels are a value between 0 and 255, assuming it's grayscale. If it's so this data is grayscale. We can also work on color images. Then we'll have an RGB channel. It'll be another three dimensions. So this is very simple, just black and white images. We're going to scale it to a value between 0 and 1. And so we're just dividing it by 255. So that's all this particular step does. You can again look into how it looks. So again, numpy arrays. So just do one. You can see all the entries for one particular. So it's 784. You can look into what the shape is. It's 784. And individual values are these. It's 0 and some values for the first particular record. Okay, so again, the data on 60,000 records take a long time to train. So we're going to work only on a very, very small subset of data. We'll just take the number 6 and we'll try to classify, we'll build a model to recognize if that number is 6 or not. So the approach that we're going to take is we're going to take all 6 from the trained data set. So that's about 5,918. You can always go and verify this. And once you have this, to make a balanced data set, we're going to take from the remaining 54,000 records, we're going to take another 6,000 data points, randomly selecting it. And we'll combine them to form our training data set. We'll use that to train if it's 6 or not. Instead of doing a multi-class classification, we'll just do a binary classification. But all the code here would run, so you can do it after the workshop. You can run this to do a multi-class classification on all the code that we have written. So the first thing that we do here, I mean, instead of changing the given one, I'm creating a new variable x, y. This tells all the, it selects all the data from a x train, which are having labels 6. Okay, and from this selects all records which are not 6. And now from this, I'm going to randomly sample 6,000. So I'm going to randomly generate 6,000 numbers, and I'm going to use that to subset my data set. And once I have that, I'm going to append it to my trained data set. So remember the, and then reshaping it so that the numbers match, and then we'll have an X train and Y train. So let's just see how this looks. Just for once, I'll suggest that you run it with print statements in between. So let's run it line by line to understand what's happening. So this, we're just copying it. So you can, so this is an easy part. So you can just see. We're just converting everything to 0, 1. This is the condition that it applies. And converting it to, if you know NumPy better, it's easier to do with np.where, but I just thought this is easier to show. Then just do this. So it takes all, okay, it has a unique value of just 6, right? So everything, so all the records are just 6. It's the same code, just that I'm flipping this to not 6, so you'll have everything as not 6. Now if you do np.unique of y not 6, you'll see everything except 6, so you'll have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You don't have 6 there. This is the same data set we'll use for rest of today. So if you look into random rows, it just creates a random number for x6. And we can use this to take So if you look into this, this may not be balanced, but most probably. In fact, it's not that bad. You can very well happen, you can randomly generating, so it can very well happen that you may not have balanced between other classes, but that's okay because this is all the numbers which are not 6. So you're just trying to see if it's 6 or not 6, right? So. Once you have that, you're just going to append the training data set as all your 6 and not 6. And then your labels are your y6 and not 6. So you have, so if you look into, it's just 0, 1. So you're converting, what this line does is converting 6, setting 6 to 1 and everything else to 0. That's what happens here. Just to check if the data set is fine. So we're not doing any transformation to the test. So test is fine. We have the same number of data sets. We just want to check if. Okay, so we have about 12,000 records for training and 10,000 to test. So we're going to build model using this 12,000 records, see what the values are, and we're going to test. First thing, for setting the number of output neurons, we specify number of classes that we want. Here we have two classes, 0 and 1, 6 and not 6. And we convert it into categorical variable. What is batch size? Batch size? Right, it's the number of samples in each mini batch. For all the things, these are all hyperparameters that you would need to work on to optimize. So first we start with relatively high. You can do smaller too, but this I thought would run within a minute. Number of epochs till number of times, after I finish one round of all my batches, how many times should I keep updating my weights? So, it's 2, and we're going to use sigmoid as the activation function. We're going to use stochastic gradient descent for learning. We'll not execute it like this. We will build it layer by layer, so you understand what's happening. It's very intuitive the way keras is done. First, we specify what model we're going to build. It's a sequential model. and I'm going to add a dense layer. I'm going to add an activation unit of sigmoid. And once that's done, I will have, this is the final output layer. Output layer has an activation, so I need two neurons. So this tells me that the number of neurons in my hidden layer, the first layer, is 512. It takes an input of 784. We need to specify this only for the first, and from the second, it automatically picks the output from the previous one. The output is two classes, and the activation to do that is softmax. You could also do sigmoid here, but it could happen that the numbers don't add up to one. We want something which is a probability two, so that's why we do a softmax. So the two neurons, one and zero, right? We specify the parameters for stochastic gradient descent. Okay, so let's see what all it needs. LR tells that it's the learning rate, and then it has a bunch of information about momentum, decay, Nesterov. So will not. Model dot? Can we use with pipelines? I mean, so if your question is, okay, so we use pipelines so the scikit-learn pipeline is used for, it expects a fit and transform, so you need to have a transform and then you need to have a fit. The keras architecture is not like that, right? So we don't have a fit here. So before the fit, you have a bunch of definitions, so it doesn't really work. Or at least I don't know. I haven't really seen. But we use pipeline in a different context. We use that for doing hyperparameter optimization. We'll see. We might talk about that a little later in this notebook. So let's not talk about the rest of the stuff here. Let's just set LR equal to 0.1. We'll talk about different parameters a little later. It tells that the learning rate is 0.1, so just update 0.1 times the gradient every time. Okay, so the compile has three metrics that you need to specify. First is the loss that needs to be optimized, and what's the learning method, and what metric are we going to track. For categorical, entropy is the metric to go. So we use a categorical cross entropy. There are other losses too. So you can use hinge loss, you can use root mean square. But root mean square doesn't really make sense for a classification problem, right? So we're going to use SGD. SGD also, we're using a plain simple one. We'll talk about what the other parameters mean a little later on. But there's a whole bunch of optimizers that's being worked on to see what works for these particular kinds of problems. So let's run this. So once the model is compiled, we're going to fit it on the data that we have. We need to specify the training data set, the label, the batch size, the number of epochs it needs to run. Verbose equal to 1 tells that display the output. We're going to track the metric that's going to be tracked as accuracy, and then that will be tracked on your validation data set. Okay, so it runs. So we have an accuracy of about 95%. Wow, okay. So run it. So the score tells what my entropy is, and accuracy tells me what my validation accuracy is. Okay. Exercise. Let's run it for 10 epochs and see how it performs. Let's copy it. Okay, exercise now. Run the above code so that you get a sense of how this works. Increase the number of epochs to 10 and see how the error is. So increasing, decreasing for 25. That's one set of hyperparameters. The other hyperparameters is your batch size. The third one too, is the hidden layer. Okay, let's do this for the next 5 minutes to get a feel of how this works. Yes. Yeah, I don't know. But yeah. Right. Okay, anyone had challenges running? Did it work? Any insights?
What is the value loss and value accuracy?
What is?
It prints out val loss equals.
Okay.
What are those?
Okay, so it prints four, right? One is, what is the training? Entropy, so the loss that we're using is entropy, categorical entropy, and the accuracy we're tracking is classification accuracy. Loss is on the training loss, it's on your training data set. So when you train, you always try to minimize your training error, right? That's what happens. So it tells how each epoch is evolving, what the training loss is. And then the accuracy tells that at each end of each epoch, how's my network performing on my validation data set?
So when it says the loss is 0.595 and then the value loss is 0.491, why is there a difference between those two numbers? What does that mean?
Right. So what does it mean? It means that my training, I'm getting better information from my training. It needs to be lower. So my validation is performing better than my training. That's all. This is the validation data set.
So the training is the
It's a test data set, the one that you pass in your...
Oh.
It's not your training data set. So this is your 10,000 data points that you pass over here as your validation data set. And no, validation is what we want to test it on to see the accuracy of our model. No, no. So what we do is that we build a model on train. So remember what you told about 80-20, right? We build a model on one set of data. We can have like 100 different models. Which model should I select? I want to select a model which generalizes well, which works well on unseen data. Since we cannot go into production and get unseen data, what we do is we take a part of the data and keep it as a test data set and run the model and evaluate on that test data set to see how accurate the model is. And that's what it tells here. Yeah, the model is built on, so the model parameters are selected based on the training data set, but we want to know how the model performs on any data set. So here that any data set is the test data set. Yes. Okay, so yes, I mean, when we do, that's how we do. So we... If you're going to build like hundreds of models, you use some data set to build your model and you want to test it on that. But this is more for learning purpose. So we just, so here we are not using the test data set for learning at all, right? So everything that we are learning is only from the trained data set. And once we learn from the trained data set, we are going to run it on the test data set and see how it is good. That problem arises only if you want to use your test data set also into training. In some sense, but you're right. In typical practice, we generally have another set of data. It's like telling, I'm going to keep it in a safe, and only all of you build the models, and you give it to me. I will run it on my data set, and I'll tell you which model I want to take. That's how we should do. We call that data snooping in machine learning. So, yeah. Okay, so you get a sense for how, yes. Yes, I'll do that. It's at the end of the notebook. We'll do exercises on those two. I'm not explaining that, but yeah, we'll... So did everyone get a chance to change the neurons, number of neurons, change the batch size? So we are still at one hidden layer. We still haven't gone outside a hidden layer. We're still at one hidden layer. So the next step is to go and add more layers, right? So that's what we're doing here. So we have dense. We add another set of 512 neurons as another hidden layer, and also using a sigmoid activation function. We'll still keep this to one. And everything is the same, and we're going to run this. And this is how you go, this is now a multi-layer perceptron. That was just a single layer perceptron. Now we'll have multi-layer, we have many layers. We have two layers here. How do you add a three layer? It's very easy, just go here and add and you get a three layer. We probably need to train for a little more to get better accuracy, but that's it. So it's very easy. You specify that the sequential model, just recapping it, you specify it's a dense layer. Activation, what's the activation function that you want to use on the neurons? Okay, before, so I had a very interesting question over there telling that train dataset is balanced, but is the test dataset balanced? No, test dataset is not balanced, right? So what's the simple benchmark that you can get on your test dataset? I mean, that you would see, but what's an easy way to get a benchmark? I want a benchmark score. Set everything to be not 6. If you set everything to not 6, what's the accuracy you'll be getting? 0? It's 94%, yes. You would get that because your training data set has, your test data set has only about 600 data points, which are 6, and everything else is 0, right? Which is not 6. There are 606 and roughly, and everything else is not 6. So you're going to get an accuracy of about 94%. So if you're telling that my validation accuracy is 0.9, then all we are inferring is that the model is predicting some of the, many of the non-6s to be 6.2. Okay, so a biggest challenge in neural networks is overfitting. You have so many connections that keeps coming in. So think about the model I just ran. It has 784 inputs. It gets connected to 512 units in the next layer. And each of those 512 units gets connected to another 512 units in the next layer, which in turn is again connected to another 512 units in the third layer. So you're getting around 800 into 500 into 500 into 500 weights, which gets connected to two output classes, right? So I don't know, maybe if it's definitely more than a million. I don't know how much, but we have, do we have more than a million weights? We have more than a million parameters in our model. How many data points do we have? We have less than 12,000 data points. What's an easy way for a neural network to learn? It can memorize everything, right? It doesn't need to learn. When you have a million parameters, you just need 12,000 parameters to learn everything. And so this particular process is called overfitting. If you've done machine learning, you already know what overfitting is. Overfitting is just that instead of just learning the signal, you learn both signal and the noise. And your noise dominates when you train it on your trained data set. So we use a concept called regularization. Regularization is a technique for preventing overfitting. One way that we have seen so far is to use cross-validation. We'll now impose constraints on the model to ensure that the model tries to learn better. Yes. Got a question? Okay, so, yes. Somebody have a question? Okay, so there are two ways where regularization can be used. One is by a technique called dropout. For that, I will have to come back to. Which is what we saw. We'll look into dropout right now. We may well do some of the other stuff a little later. We'll do data augmentation as the last thing today. For people who asked weight delay in your SGD, this is what it is. So we'll come to that also very soon. By far, this is an extremely powerful technique. This is your model that you have, right? So you have your neuron. It takes inputs from your previous layer, and it goes. What happens with a dropout is, at any particular point in training, there's a probability associated with each of the neuron to be available for training or not. Generally, we set it to 50%. That's a rule of thumb. What it tells is that when the training happens, not all neurons will be available for training. Only 50% of the neurons will be available for training. So this helps the network learn on its own rather than relying on what its neighbors are learning. It may not have these two when it learns. It just vanishes. And this is what happens. So you have a model. This is what we had. When we use dropout during training, these particular nodes are dropped. So assume that this is also a hidden layer. So these are dropped. So there's no connection that goes in. There's no connection that comes in. So we learn. So this ensures that the network is more robust to noise than learning everything. So very simple concept. We'll go and implement that in our code. All we are going to do is that we're going to add this particular line of code over here. It's the same code that we ran before. We're just going to add a layer called dropout. Yes.
So the question for dropout, so when you drop the nodes out, your vectors have now changed sizes. So do you hold, do you imputate, or what do you do?
Okay. You don't drop the vectors, so it's just that. So while training, you have different, so when your model ends, you will eventually have a model like this. You will have a model, when the training ends, you will have a model, fully dense model, with every weight being set. Just that during training, at any point of the epoch, not all neurons will be available for training. So that's the only thing that gets induced. Telling there is a probability that it can be there or not. If it's not there, the input doesn't go through the next neuron, and there's no output coming from it. That's the only difference. But when you finish the training, you will have everything. There'll be a weight set for every particular edge. No. So we, good question. All sigmoid does is just this. It tells that given my output, I'm going to tell what my output is. My input is just a weighted sum of the previous node's output multiplied by a weight, right? So that's all that comes into a particular neuron. And I'm going to apply a squashing function. I'm going to give something out. That's all this does. What dropout does is that it's going to remove certain nodes with a probability. We are going to specify the probability as the layer. So a layer like this, that we specify in our code is just this. We're going to add something called a dropout layer. And that's a way of thinking about it. All it tells is the probability that a particular node will be available during the training epoch is only 20%. So we are going to specify probability here. probability is another hyperparameter that you need to optimize. Okay, so that's the only thing that we add here. We do that. Dropout is not defined. Okay. Let's get us to clear. Yes, thank you. Okay, so just run this from keras.layers, import dropout. Yes. It's one epoch, that's it. Yes. I mean, that only if you introduce for each epoch, then there is something stochastic about it. If you drop from there on, then it becomes deterministic for the next round of epoch of learning to memorize it, right? So. I mean, this is a place where keras has made life so easy. In Tiana, you'll have to actually specify what the input vector for the next layer is. And for every time you change a probability, you'll have to compute what the input dimension for the next vector is. And it used to be so painful. Well, let's run the same thing for 15 epochs and see what happens. This is going to be sloppy and add the value here. Okay, it's so this is a hyperparameter. You'll have to play around with it to see how many dropout layers you need and how to set it. So this particular code, it's an exercise. For this particular code that we have, add one more hidden layer of sigmoid and add one more dropout layer and see how it runs. We'll give an experience of adding layers for you. Okay, please do this. Run the above code, but run it for 15 epochs. Add one more hidden layer with sigmoid activation units, and add dropouts. This time set probability to 0.5. Good question. I didn't change. It should be, it's 128. Yeah, it's 128. It's 128. Did everyone get what we are doing here? Questions? So we're just stacking layers, more hidden layers, more regularization terms. And it's always a good thing that good rule of thumb is that when you add an additional hidden layer, also add a regularization layer to that. Because the complexity increases, and it's always a good thing to control complexity. Okay, you can do that too, but 512 can capture. See, our data size is not huge. It's pretty small for neural networks, right? When you actually work on large scale, you would probably need complex networks. And at that time, you would say if you have 1 million data points, you would still probably have only like 512 or relatively smaller hidden units in each layer. And you want to, even something like this, even if you have 1 million data points, this particular two-layer network has 1 million weights, right? So. When you would know, right? When you start specifying it, it's just exponentially increasing. Yes, I'll just go. Yes. Right. So the other the challenge also here is that no two problems are similar. So if you look into problems that people are solving, even in images, people use different architectures, and we haven't even introduced convolution yet, and that's another set of we'll do two more stuff: convolution and autoencoders. The kind of layers that you introduce also, there's no theoretical backing. So we have intuitive backing, but right. People are working on it, yes. No, I mean, no, these kind of architectures are fairly. Right. For now, the only strong theoretical background that we have is the kind of learning that we can have for deep learning, backpropagation, gradient descent. So these things have very strong theoretical backing that it works. But for an example, like why dropout works, it just worked when people experimented on it. Now we're finding theory on why that works. It's a fairly recent concept. Right, I mean, and that explanation is fairly recent. So when droppers were introduced, they weren't thought of as a cheap way of doing ensembles. This is different. So we'll talk about that later. So neural networks has. That's like the biggest problem. That's the reason why it didn't take off for many years. Because the moment you add two layers, a million data points, you're going to hit a local minimum one way or the other. Dropouts is a way where it could overcome by regularizing the model, by reducing the complexity. What it does is that, like what he told, so if you've done random forest, gradient boosting, you will know that a model with this particular node is a different model than a model with this particular node not being there. So you're just having different neural network models and you're just averaging them. You can think of dropouts as a way of accomplishing that particular task. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Not necessarily. You just don't want the same parameters in every run. And as long as you don't have it, you cannot learn the... Oh, sure. I'm not denying that. The data size that we are dealing with is so small. That's perfectly possible.
Do you think it makes sense if I drop out, I put a much smaller drop out, the remaining rate, say, but drop out equals 0.005?
Okay, there is no theoretical backing. We can do an experiment. And that's the only way, which is the same technique that we follow. We have a test data set. We want to figure out a model which works well on the test data set. Yes.
Is the accuracy supposed to expect it to increase?
Is the accuracy for this test? No, so test we don't know. We don't have any control. We're not using that. What we need to see is the training loss, is it decreasing? And is the training accuracy increasing? Those are the two metrics that we are watching. So what's the model doing? The model is, if you look into it, the model is the loss that we are measuring is categorical entropy. So invariably, almost the next epoch will have a better entropy. Here it's lower.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessarily the case. I would expect it not to increase much, even if it increases. That was one of the reasons why, for this particular data set, there are challenges that we would talk about by the time we get to the next notebook. So it's a concept that we were talking a little before. It's the concept called local minima. But regularization, these things can help you circumvent that in a different way. The bigger challenges in training deep networks are two things. It's called vanishing gradient and called exploding gradient. Okay, so for that, let's get back to, I need a good. Okay. So this is the function that we are using, right? Sigmoid. So sigmoid, the challenge with sigmoid is that you will have a gradient only if your values are between a very narrow range. It's good, and in some cases, it's bad also, because here you have good gradient. You will have gradients that you can learn on. But if your value is far to the left, your input to your activation function, the weighted sum, if it's far to the left or far to the right, you're almost at a flat level of your curve. So your gradient there is so small. So when you have, that's called vanishing gradient, and you have a gradient, and you're going to use gradient to update, so which is what your backpropagation will give your gradient here. Let's say at one of the earlier layers, the gradient is small. What it means is that it cannot really learn much because it's still stuck here. It needs to come somewhere here for it to make a transition to your next class. For example, it's grossly misclassifying it as 0 while it is 1, but it is stuck here. Your gradient is stuck here. So you know the gradient descent algorithm. What it does, your weight, it changes it by your gradient times a small learning rate. The learning rate is generally said to be very small, right? So you're just nudging it very slowly. Even after many epochs, it could still be stuck there. It cannot make the transition to the other side. And that particular process is called vanishing gradient. That generally happens at the earlier layers, and that means that it cannot really learn and cannot pass enough information. So if it happens in layer 1, that it's stuck here, but it needs to be there, the information cannot really pass on to the other layers, so it's still going to propagate wrong values. This is a big problem with neural networks. A similar problem is exploding gradients. Instead of having it, the gradients can quickly explode, and that happens at the later layers, and it cannot send enough information back. And so, we will come to the okay. So we talked about dropouts. We can also add regularizers, which is like your L2 regularization in your logistic regression, and then you can specify that my lambda parameter is 0.01, and you can run. So this is so there we played with a regularization on the architecture. Here we're playing it with individual neurons. So that's the difference here. Okay. The third way that we can control is through SGD. So we'll talk about SGD now. So SGD has a learning rate, but it also you can also specify momentum and weight decay. Okay, think about momentum as in physics, right? You're rolling a ball down. We saw that in gradient descent. Let's go to the example of gradient descent. We are here. We are rolling the ball down. As it keeps going up, it picks up momentum. The way the algorithm is currently set up, when it hits bottom, it stops. But when you roll a ball down, you know that it has a momentum, it bounces a little up. When you have a cost function, something like this, you don't know if this is minimum or this is minimum. What you do is, because of the momentum, it can raise a bit. And you're going to look at the field a little above. And if there's an escape path out of it, you go and explore that particular path. That's the physical interpretation of what momentum does. So you specify momentum parameter to overcome local minima problem in your stochastic gradient descent. Again, we are not training on the entire data set. We are training it only on mini batches. And this could very well happen for a mini batch. And we want to find a way to come out of it. Okay. And there's a weight decay also. So do you want the decay to be uniform, or it's rapid initially, and then it gradually tapers off towards the end? So should your weight decay be uniform, or I want to rapidly decay? So initially, the weight changes are large. And then as I learn, I just want to slowly nudge and look around. I don't want to take long steps. Okay. It's a decay of the LR parameter, I guess. Yes. OK, so until so far, we have seen only sigmoid activation function. We'll introduce. OK, so sigmoid activation function, we saw that has a vanishing gradient problem, right? So we're going to use something called a rectified linear unit. It's extremely simple. There's no, if the value is, there is some, if the value is less than 0, it's 0. Otherwise, it's the output of that value. So it's an extremely simple unit, easier to differentiate. The major advantage people found using this is that the training time increased quite fast because you don't have this vanishing gradient problem. Because the gradient here is doesn't have any it's the number, right? There's nothing to vanish here, so it's easier to compute. Slightly generalized form of ReLU, rectified linear unit, is max out. So this is rectifier, and then we go, and then we can specify that at each particular threshold, this is the value that I want. So it can help approximate even a quadratic function using linear functions. And when you have quadratic functions, any functions, they can again have a vanishing gradient problem. And you can use an approximated max out unit to resolve that problem. So I've just written a function for the same code that we wrote above. The only change here is that the activation is passed as a parameter. Don't run this. This takes a while to run. It takes about 5-10 minutes to run. So you can just copy the previous code that we have. And then you can change sigmoid to ReLU. Should I change this also to ReLU? No, you don't change this layer to ReLU. You just change the hidden layers to ReLU. The output is softmax, so that gives you need a probability. This is your output unit, and then you run this. You can run a lot more epochs on this because it's faster. Okay, so we'll take a 10-minute break. We'll meet again at 10:45, and we'll start convolution neural networks. They'll go on for an hour, and we'll do a bit of unsupervised learning and other techniques to other regularization techniques that we saw. So if you have any questions, I'll be around here, so feel free to drop it. We'll start exactly at 10:45. It's good to know this. So the challenge that somebody actually brought me up, a very interesting point, is that so far what we have done is that we have converted the image 28 by 28 into a 784 one-dimensional vector. The challenge, okay, it's given us a lot of weights, it's done a lot of stuff, but one of the challenges it has introduced is that it has lost the spatial relationship. It's not, I mean, when you write 6 or any number, it matters what your neighbors are, right? That's one of the reasons why something like a K nearest neighborhood also have a very good accuracy on this model, which means that there are features that's not getting captured. While we think that neural networks, the multi-layer perceptron has learned that, it's probably kind of hard to understand or interpret what it's learning. Instead, let's go back to what I told start of today, is that we create a hierarchical learning, and that's what convolution neural network is all about. In convolution nets, so think about this. This is the input, and from each input, from each image, we learn certain patch of information at each level. We call this particular learning called a feature map, where it takes a particular kind of, so for example, all it tells us that is there an edge on the left-hand top could just be one particular feature. And that could just slide over the entire image. Or if you know, that's something called kernel. You can apply it on your entire image, and you can get something like this. And as you keep going up, the abstraction keeps increasing, and you can get finally something like an image. Convolution is a very, very commonly used technique in image processing. An example is if you just use an emboss filter, this is what you would get. So this is one feature map. You're taking an image, and I'm creating a feature map, an emboss feature map. A similar way you can do, there are many different ways to do convolution. To think about it in numbers, you just have pixels. Pixels are represented by RGB band, or if it's grayscale, it's two dimension. And then you apply something called a kernel, a convolution kernel, on basically you have to specify what your convolution matrix is, and the kernel numbers are decided based on that. Here it's 3 by 3. Typically, I think the examples we're going to use to, okay, in simple mathematical terms, convolution is a kernel, but the way you think about that is something that takes slides over your entire image, and it's a feature map that it converts it into a sparser, a denser representation of your data. It's with some particular feature. Emboss is just one kind of kernel. In practice, we would use many kinds of kernels to do this. An example is something called a Gabber filter. If you play it on the Lina image, the four filters would give very different features of the image. And this is what internally.
Please, may I have your attention, please? We have investigated the nature of the alarm and found it to be a non-emergency. I repeat, this is a non-emergency. We apologize for any inconvenience this has caused.
Okay. Okay, so again, it's a kernel that rolls over your entire 3x3. It multiplies with this, and you get an output. That's what happens. The interpretation is it creates feature maps. Example that we saw was, this is probably harder to see, but you clearly can see emboss. So convolution neural networks uses three kinds of stuff, right? One is it takes your local field, a particular local field that you see here, and then it applies. The interesting thing about that is that for the local field, the weights are the same because you know that your kernel's fixed. The weights for all of those values are fixed. So which means that you're going to have lesser number of weights coming here in this particular layer. And we also use another concept of subsampling. So once you learn the feature map, we are going to subsample, downsample it. An easy way of sampling it is called, it's called pooling, where you have your image like this, and I take a 2x2 or a 3x3, and I replace it with either the sum, the square, the minimum, the maximum. It's called okay, so this is an example of max pooling. It's very hard to see from there. Yeah, we'll go to the notebook after this slide, so just bear with this particular slide. So we take every 2x2, and then we replace. We create a smaller matrix with just the maximum of it. So this makes it even denser. You'll have even lesser weights going. As you grow from left to right in the network, the number of weights keep reducing. This is an example of how this is being used. You have your input 32x32 or 28x28. You have a lot of convolution filters that's applied. And then you applied your sigmoid layer, and then you subsample it, and then you send it to your output. So that's sure. Yeah. So that's you could either do padding or no padding. Those are parameters to your filter, right? And okay. The what? The what? The code. I don't know. I have to ask Hinton for that. I don't know. So, I mean, this worked. I mean, again, through experiments, it worked. Now, there are theory being built on why this works. What are the mathematical properties for that? So we're still trying to understand. Empirically, this works. Okay, so that's something that you're going to hear a lot in deep learning. You're going to throw this. You can introduce an architecture and you call that a new network. Okay, an example that we talked about, and we talked about vanishing gradients, right, or exploding vanishing gradients. So what you could do is you can take an input, and the value can be passed as an input to a layer down, in addition to the gradient itself. That's currently the state of art for doing it. It's a similar network, but there you pass the gradient to. It's called residual network, right? So if you read about what the best model for image processing is, it's residual network. I can share, I have some implementations of that. I can share the code. It's on my GitHub repo. So it's very similar to this network. There's just it adds one more residual and this is the architecture. You'll have convolution layer, you'll have subsampling, and that keeps going. It's a deep convolution network. So you stack one convolution after another. I'm going to talk about this. This is the Google Net model. You can see that, even from here, it's very hard to figure out. So just use the color. So blue is like convolution. They use so many poolings. You have some softmax. You have other networks. It's really deep, and it takes a few weeks to train. Okay, so we'll implement this for our data set. Let's please open 5 convolution nets. So from layers, we're going to import convolution and max pooling. Right, so these steps are the same as the previous one. So I'm just going to run until here. Okay, so now the parameters that we need to set are the number of filters that we need to use for convolution layer. Setting it as 32. Another hyperparameter to optimize if you want to figure out what the exact number is. What is the pooling dimension that I should look into for? So if I'm going to use max pooling, should I do 2x2 or 3x3? The question that came was if I use 3x3, and if it's 28, 28 is not 3 is not a multiple for 28, is 3, so how do we handle it? In that case, you use something called padding. So either pad, do you need to provide padding, or do you ignore them? So these are parameters that you need to specify. For now, we're going with default parameters. It's too many hyperparameters to optimize. Did you guys hear the sound? It's like. Okay, so we'll do Q&A until it comes. So. So that's all there is to convolution networks. We're just going to run through the code with different convolution layers and different max pooling layers and figure out a strategy that works well. Yes? No, a deep is one where you have many layers. Correct. Yeah, the moment you add more than one, it's called deep. So the simplest to start with is just a multi-layer perceptron. That's what we did. And then we figured out that maybe there's a different way to encode your input, different way to learn. And so if you look into it, one layer to another layer is just building upon that, right? So you, it's, if you would call that as some sense an unsupervised learning. So that's something that you will hear a lot in deep learning. People will tell, oh, you don't need to create features because it learns features on its own. So you just give the raw data and it learns, and almost you'll see a lot of talks which says, oh, that's why we use deep learning, because it learns features on its own. You don't need to build features. While if you do traditional machine learning algorithm, random forest, logistic regression, you need to hand code the features. I'm not done, just a minute. So, okay. So that, so you go from deep learning with multi-layer perceptrons to figuring out, okay, now weights are exploding, we have other issues, what other ways can we use to create, for example, it doesn't account into spatial structure at all. So people in image processing thought, okay, convolution is our natural way to do. Why don't we do something like that? And so became convolution networks. And many of these are very accidental discoveries through many experiments. Yes. Right. Okay. So, so if you look, this doesn't right. Okay, this pen doesn't write. It's here. So you specify what your convolution filter is for your input image, right? So you can specify many filters, and they will all have a different convolution. So this is one convolution feature. So think of that as feature map kernels, and as you specify more filters, that applies it on the input image. So this input image gets multiple. So this is your output of your convolution network. So these are features that it learned from your image. Now I'm going to, thank you. Now you're going to learn something on this particular layer. I'm going to do a downsampling. That's what max pooling does. Okay. No, okay, so you understand what convolution does. It just creates some feature map. It takes this particular image and it translates it into one particular point. It takes the next, and it translates it to the next data point. So it keeps sliding over, and then for every 2x2 or 3x3, it multiplies it with this kernel, and you have a number, right? So that's learning some particular feature from here. Max pooling takes it even one step further, telling that once I have learned something about that particular space, I just want the highest signal from that particular space. I don't care about which location it is. I don't care if it's top left, if it's just 4 pixels, I don't care if it's top or bottom, I just need the highest of it. I'm just going to replace that with telling that there is a signal. So it's just another representation of what you have learned.
If I already have a model and I don't want to start from scratch, can you use a pre-trained?
Yeah, you can use pre-trained models. Okay, so very interesting question. One of the reasons why we have a vanishing gradient problem is because the weights are initialized. So you would probably use a uniform distribution to assign, and you know that within, except for a narrow range, everything else may not really contribute much. You're going to take a longer time to train. So instead of it, a pre-trained model can give you a jump start with training already done, with an architecture with weights already set, and you start from there and you start training your model. So it gives you a better start than where you would start if you start randomly. Yeah, keras supports. Yes. Yeah. It's best a wrapper. Everything that Theano does, Keras allows you to do. So, it's just a wrapper on top of. As I told, Theano is you need to know how symbolic computation works, and you have full control over what parameters you specify. Keras just provides you a lot of defaults, and that's the reason why. You would think so, but then because these are just empirical models with empirical results with no theory, I've seen people use it for lots in all sorts of ways. Or at least I'm not aware of any theoretical, thank you so much, any theoretical proof on why and what class of pre-trained models you should use for a particular class of problems. So again, deep learning models are just empirical, and for example, I can just the kind of the Linet model that I just showed. And it's difficult to find a theoretical motivation for that to be used in a particular setting. For example, if someone wants to be issued a loan or not, or a credit card or not, you cannot use those models. It has no theoretical proof to tell that I can use it for legal purposes or not, right? Debatable, right? So. Yes. At least in the bare sense, you would know that you have a better start than starting randomly. You have some empirical evidence to start in a particular way. And yeah, if you, in the industry, a lot of times we use pre-trained models to get started. It's easier to experiment and do a lot of stuff. Right. 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 But you can have models which are pre-trained on millions of images, right? Like the ImageNet model. No, I mean, newer architectures are, so there are two sets of things, right? So, awesome, thanks. Okay, awesome. So we have newer kinds of algorithms being, newer kinds of architectures being designed. Two things come to my mind. One is residual networks. That is adversarial networks. These are two things that are very actively being developed and researched upon. Another thing is people are figuring out theory. There's a lot of research being done to figure out what's the theory, why this works. Okay, there's an empirical evidence, but can we find a theoretical underpinning? So that's something that's happening a lot in the academia. Right. Right. No, these are rotational invariants. So we'll talk about that, and if we get to seventh notebook, we can actually. I'll give you a heads up. So we have some kind of data. So for example, we start with like what you told. We have only less number of data, right? So one way to increase. So networks behave better. You learn better when you have more data. So one way is to artificially generate data with existing data. For images, a very easy way to do is just rotate it, right? You can do rotation, you can shear the images, and if you rotate 6, it's still 6 for some degrees, right? If you shear it, it's still 6 until for quite a lot of shear. So you can keep doing that and keep adding your appending to your data set, and you can use that to model. So that's something that happens. The structure still remains the same, even if you do that. Okay, so here we added one convolution layer. So again, rule of thumb, in convolution, we generally use rectified linear unit as our activation function rather than sigmoid. It just makes it faster. And one thing is, so this model definitely has lesser number of parameters than the multilayer perceptron that we ran in the previous notebook. We can go and add more dense layers. This is a way where we can add more hidden layers, which are ReLU. Or we can go and we can add more convolution layers. That's also fine. So that's deep. Okay. So is that something? Okay. what's the good question? So what's the structure of a convolution output? It's taken an image, and the output of a convolution layer is also an image, right? So if you're working on grayscale, like here, it's 28 by 28. The output is, again, based on padding. You can have approximately 26, 28, 30, something like that. So you will have, again, an image, depending on where you're padding, how you do the padding. But then for your hidden layer, your dense layer, which does sigmoid or ReLU, you need it as one particular vector, as one column vector. And so we flatten it. Flatten, all it does is that it converts it into, it just reshapes it into one particular. That's all it does. That, strictly, that's not a layer. It just transforms it before it sends it to the next layer. So whenever you have a convolution layer and you flatten it. Again, so this has lesser number of weights. We can go and we can add dropouts to this. Just wait for this to run. Okay. So when we start, we start with a bunch of images. Then we are going to do some transformation to get an output, right? So this is what we want. First, what we do is we apply a convolution filter here and get convolution maps for all the images. And once you have, so this is one layer, convolution layer. You could just use like that, but empirically, it's proven that you can also do, you can pool it to get better accuracy. So this is still working on the images. So once you do that, you come and you introduce hidden layers. And then you pass it to the softmax to run. So this is an example of a convolution network. So now, what we can also do is that add one more convolution layer as here. So the output of this convolution layer is the input of the max pooling layer is the input to another convolution network. Okay, what does it even mean? It's that gets, so this is easy to interpret. That gets slightly harder as you keep stacking convolution networks. In some sense, it's just still trying to learn some intensities from the images, the input that it gets. And all dropout is trying to do, dropout acts only on this layers, not doesn't act there. So it just acts here to figure out, okay, when I come to my input, to my dense layer, what percentage of them should be available for each epoch? No, but that's only, yeah, right, but no, because you're sliding it over the entire image. So you will end up with, so you start with the 28 by 28, you will end up with, yeah, with the 28 by. The only thing is, it's better representation of your data, so you learn better features from this particular layer, right? So if you do a multi-layer perceptron kind of stuff, you're losing your spatial information. So here I'm doing that, instead of doing five multi-layer perceptron, five layers of hidden layers, if I add two convolution layers, number of weights reduce, first of all, because they all have the shared weight because all these points represent the same numbers, and the size of this reduces. And you also learn structure around your local field. We call that convolution layers, yes. Yes. See, I mean, so this is abusing the terminology, but there is an input layer, there is output layer. Everything that's input is in between is called hidden layer. Hidden layer just means that it's not input, it's not output. Every other layer is hidden layer. People tend to use it in different ways, but there's really no meaning on what. Is it really hidden? Can we really not see? Nothing like that. It's just that it's not input, it's not output. That's it. Does it answer your question? Okay, so we can do all the same stuff that we did before. We can add more dropouts, we can add more convolution layers. I'll let you guys play with this for 5 minutes before we go to the next notebook. Yes.
So for this notebook here, it seemed that it didn't matter what hyperparameter or parameter I used, I always got exactly the same accuracy.
Okay. It's either overfitting or it's not learning enough. And that's not surprising because the data is not enough. You just have, it's like telling that I have 1,000,000 parameters, I'm adding another 1,000,000 parameters, but the data is not learning because it's already learned enough. It's not able to get out of that. Yeah, you could reduce the size of the layers. You can try to find more data. So for the same data set, notebook 7, we're running the exact same stuff on by artificially inflating data, generating data. So we'll do that after this. We'll do 7 and then come back to 6. I'm not aware, but you could probably... Right. I'm not sure. While we wait, we can check that. So this is keras documentation, keras.io. You can try changing ReLU to sigmoid and see how it changes. You can change the probability in dropout. You can play with the pool size for max pooling. You can also change the number of filters. It's a lot of hyperparameters to work on. You're all done? Okay, let's go to notebook 7, where we learn how to add images to what we currently have. There's no exercise here. I'll just walk you through the code. These things are the same as what we did before. We just get 6, not 6, until this, it's all the same. Now we're going to rotate the image. There is a function in SciPy called image rotate, im rotate. I'm going to rotate it by an angle of 15 degrees to the left. I can do it two ways. I can either do it clockwise or I can do it anti-clockwise. I'm going to do both ways. So this is an example where I'm going to do clockwise, anti-clockwise, and we're going to let it run for all the images. So if you look into it, this is just for all the images. I'm going to rotate for every image. I'm going to take it, and I'm going to rotate it. So let's do that. This code is going to take some time to run, maybe about 2 minutes. Just written a helper function which takes the original image clockwise and anti-clockwise and use matplotlib to show that. So this is the original 6 image. If you rotate it 15 degrees, this is what you get clockwise. Rotate it. Okay, why do we do this? There's also a new set of problems that's been found in deep learning models. There are things which human eye can detect, even with small distortion, but it changes the way deep learning can recognize. You might think, for example, in ImageNet, people conducted experiments and they figured out that the models perform much better than normal human beings. It's very difficult for normal human beings to correctly classify a lot of those images with the accuracy that the current state of our deep learning algorithms do. These are things that that human beings can figure out is with small distortions. These are called adversarial images. Okay, I have no idea why this is coming. So one way to generate images is to add distortions to the image and also use it for training. What we are here doing here is just rotating it, but you could also add transformations and use that as input. So this is another example for another data point where it shows. And now that we have three data sets, it's all similar stuff. Let's reshape them and run the multi-layer perceptron. So now, when we first ran, we just had 12,000 images. And now it's reshaped to run with 36,000, almost 36,000 images, right? It has about 35,754 images. Okay, don't do 50. 50 will take like a long time to run. By 50, I had accuracy of about, it was almost 0.99, which is much better than the models that we used. So the previous models, accuracy was about 0.96, 97. But with just the same data set, we're able to correctly classify almost 98.5 to 99% accuracy. There's just tilting 15 degrees. You can add more ways of tilting, and you can do other stuff. Okay, we had a... Yeah, it remains like this for a while and then it drops. So if you want to try, you can try for 50. Okay, questions on this? So if you work with not enough data, this is one way to increase your data. Okay, so far we have seen supervised learning. We'll do a little bit of unsupervised learning. Unsupervised learning is called autoencoder. Do a bit of slides to explain that. It's very similar to neural network. We're going to keep encoding. We're going to come up with some representation here. The interesting thing here is that the input and the output are the same. So you basically want a better reconstruction of your input. And that's what this tries to do. So deep autoencoder is when you encode it and you take the output of the encoding and then you pass it on to the next encoder. So that's called a deep autoencoder. We would do a hands-on using autoencoding using convolution layers. That's also something that you could do. We're not doing deep autoencoders here, but let's see. So these are all the same set of code. Let's run this. So we need to provide an encoding dimension. We're going to do this for 32. We know what the input shape is, 37, 784. We're going to do it to 32. So the architecture should remain same. So as you go from, so when I go from encoding input to encoding, I'm going to encode from 784 to 32. When I decode, I again get back to 784. So it should be similar. You could use different activation functions. For example, in dense, I'm using ReLU. I can again use ReLU here, or I can change sigmoid, but it's still a dense network. So we'll do convolution, we'll do max pooling also down. But this is the simplest of the autoencoding stuff. Now we'll run this. Here we use an optimizer called Ada Delta. SGD will not work here. Okay, this will take some time to run. Hundred will take some time, but that's okay. Let's just run it for 20. Okay, now we'll run it, we'll predict it on the test data set. So it's now encoded, learned a better representation of the test data set. And we're going to plot it. So this is an example of how the first few, I think the first 10 that we're going to show. N is equal to 10. We're going to show how many digits we're going to display. This is how it looks. Different representation. Places where this is used is predominantly a good application is denoising documents, where there's been empirical evidence that an image that starts like this can end up with something like this. Here we're going the other way, but understand that we're going from 784 to 32. Is that what we used? Yeah, we used 32. So it just needed from 784 to 32 to show something like this. So it's, and as you run for more epochs, it learns the features better. And this can be fed as input to your model. So this is one way where you can decrease the dimensionality of your feature space. Okay, we can also go and add, so we have the same data set. Instead, it's the same data set. It's all the same code until we come here where we are going to add a convolution layer. So we do an input image, we take a convolution layer, we do a max pooling. On the other side of the encoder, we have a convolution again, but we have an upsampling to, it's the anti-max pooling. We do an upsampling and get the decoded stuff. So we use ReLU here and sigmoid here. And the rest of the code are exactly the same as before. The difference between the previous one and this one is the previous one didn't have a convolution layer. This one we are doing a convolution and max pooling. Okay, this training will take some time. So one thing you can already see is that the validation loss is much lower than what it was before. Validation loss here was like 0.18 when we ended. And here, where are we? And it starts, and even in the third epoch, it's hit 0.08. So this is already better. Even the second iteration, second epoch is much better than what the best epoch, the best results from the previous model. No, it's just, no, you're just learning features from, that's all convolution layer does. Yeah. So. Right. Exactly. Not really, because there've been competitions, ImageNet competitions, and convolution neural networks have outperformed every other kinds of model. Because it's faster, you can do deeper models too. So for the same amount of time, so if you're running the model for a week, you can probably explore a much complex model in convolution networks than other architectures. Okay, so it took like 2.5 minutes to run, but we ended up with a loss of 0.606. Let's do it on the test, and we'll do the same stuff. Let's display some of those images. Okay, so this is all there is to it. It took... So it's efficiently reconstructed the original image just using 32 points. So 784 has been compressed to 32 just using this particular architecture, right? Now you can use this as an input to your model, and now you would have lesser data points than lesser number of parameters, so it's going to be faster, at least visually.
May I have your attention, please? We have investigated the nature of the alarm that just sounded and found it to be a non-emergency. I repeat, this is a non-emergency. We apologize for any inconvenience this has caused.
Okay. Haven't really run, but that's an exercise that you can go. You can take the output of this and you can train a convolution neural network model and see what kind of accuracy you get. We've done only two class, but the entire MNIST dataset is there and all the code will run for that. It's just going to take a few more minutes, 2 hours. So this is something I generally do. Before I go to sleep, I start computing and then I go to sleep and I wake up. I'll have to kill the laptop so that I can use it again. It's just a fit an autoencoder means to compute a denser representation of your data, a better representation than what you have. So for example, we had a 28x28 784, right. And we're forcing it to represent only in 32. Number. Oh, your output layer is your input layer. So I have 5. The output has to be 5, right? Backpropagation, same thing. You're going to do the same thing. Yeah, it's your input is your target. So input and target are the same. Okay. So, good question. So let's talk about that, right? It's a compression scheme, yes. So that's what the algorithm does. So, so think about this. Forget the writing, but think about the image that we have. This is just one, but there could be multiple layers. Let's assume. So what you're going to do is this input passes through some layer of operations, which transforms the data. It again transforms to another set of layer, and we reach something called an encoded representation that we finally want. What we are going to do is we are going to use this input and decompress it using a similar kind of architecture. So here you used a convolution, you use a convolution. You use max pooling, you do up pooling. Right? So you have a similar one-for-one mapping between. So the way you come down is the way you go up to. So you use this input to see what is the output I'm getting. And the weights are all set through backpropagation. So the way it happens, so you know that when it finally finishes learning, this representation is an approximately good solution representation of your input data. Okay. So this is the output. This is not the output. I mean, this is your input and output. These are the same. So X and X. Yeah. So you want to learn something here, which the loss between this and the loss between this is very, very minimal.
Okay, so the loss function is between the output and the input.
The backpropagation does an output and input, but the way the operations happen, you want to learn the weights so that it's just a layer that is sitting in between that you want to learn. You just don't know what weights have to be set, what the numbers have to be. That's what you're trying to learn. It'll not be perfect, but you want to come up with an error metric, which is minimal. So you can specify whatever. So if you use stochastic gradient, you can probably go root mean square error, or we use ADA delta. That's an optimizer that we use. So you could use an optimizer that works well for encoding. Yes. The sparse with a denser representation. Yes. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so one resource to learn further is the neural networks and deep learning book. It's really good. It actually uses MNIST data and explain everything that we have talked about to a greater depth with treating it both mathematically and intuitively. I strongly recommend you to read that book. It's called Neural Network and Deep Learning. It's right here. It's here, this book. I haven't uploaded it yet because the slides are heavy, and I didn't want to upload it the day before the workshop because then I'll do it. I'll upload it SlideShare or speaker deck, and I'll add the link to my repository. I'll do that. Yes. It uses a very different concept. TensorFlow sets up things like a graph, so it's easier in setting that up. I mean, people use both. It's kind of hard to figure out when to make the switch. It looks like a lot more work is going on in TensorFlow than Theano. Yes. Okay, so this is Keras. So it does it in a different way. So Keras encapsulates that work for us. This is a way where we understand intuitively, and this is how Theano works. So this is not how TensorFlow works. It's not a one-on-one mapping. No, you will get different times depending on your architecture. There are places where TensorFlow is faster, and there are architectures where, for example, convolution neural networks, TensorFlow is faster from my experience. And for recurrent nets, it's almost similar or slightly slower. Right. So compiling generally is slightly faster. Fitting takes a long time. Compile time is, even for a very complicated network, the order of magnitude should not be that different. It's the fitting time where the way it learns, the way data gets moved to GPU, those things matter. And you can never build large scale. You can never run large scale on your CPU. You need GPUs to run this. And the way things are handled at the GPU side is different in TensorFlow and Theano. And that makes a difference. I'm not sure if Torch compiles faster, but okay. Any more questions? Okay. We finished the workshop. Thanks, everyone.